Good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name's Ted Kesik, and I'm a faculty member here at Daniels, and I always say I have the good fortune of being able to coordinate this Building Ecology, Science, and Technology lecture series. It's been a lot of fun. It's now entering its seventh year, and for that we have to thank the generous support of TREMCO Roofing and Maintenance. It's a lecture series that we've always hoped would somehow get at the intersection between ecology, science, and technology in the built environment, and that's what we've managed to do, and it always seems to be fun and interesting for everyone, so we're hoping we can just keep that up. Before I continue with introducing tonight's speaker and the program, I'd like to call upon Paul Sheehy of TREMCO Roofing and Maintenance to personally welcome everyone.
I know you're not here to hear me, so I'll be very short and sweet. On behalf of TREMCO, I'd like to welcome you all here today and say it's a great honor to be associated with the University of Toronto in this lecture series since 2009, I believe. And also to be, now I'm going to give you a little commercial, a short one, to be also the sponsor of the Grit Lab up top, and the fact that we still manufacture in Toronto, and we have a zero to landfill facility in Leaside, and also we have a whole team that are dedicated to zero landfill roof replacement. So on that note, I turn it back over to Ted. Thank you very much. Enjoy the evening.
I guess everyone here that's been here before realizes this, but I have to always repeat this. For those of you who would like to get some OAA continuing education credits, you have to very neatly fill out the certificates that are outside and leave them there, and then we eventually, when the students are finally done, usually the semester, because it's really hard to get them to do anything until the semester is over because they're so busy pulling all-nighters in the studio, but then eventually we do get those certificates processed and emailed to you, and then you can submit them for credit. So if you're interested in doing that, by all means. I was saying a few lectures ago, you know, this is the seventh year. I guess seventh, the number seven is a lucky number. We are expanding the Best Lecture Series franchise, again, through the generous support of TREMCO, because so there's now going to be a series. In fact, it's underway, and it's at the Université de Montréal, so that one's underway. So we have a bilingual Best Lecture Series at that School of Architecture. And another one is coming this fall to IIT in Chicago. So the idea is spreading that there's some kind of an interesting opportunity for academia and the profession to have a dialogue and talk about many of the emerging issues today. Now I'd like to introduce our speaker for this evening's lecture. Janna Levitt is a friend and a colleague, and I've had the privilege of working with her professionally. One of the aspects of her practice that I found fascinating is that Janna is not just an architect. Actually, I feel that she's an ecologist. That is, she is a person who puts living things, especially people and their relationships with one another in nature, first and foremost in her design thinking. She is less concerned about issues of formalism and technology. Not that she does not take performative design seriously, because she does, but in an era where we have so much impersonal and objectified architecture that is disconnected from the surrounding site, the community, and the building inhabitants, it is refreshing to discover that design can be otherwise, that aesthetics and civility, in the broadest sense of this often forgotten term, are not mutually exclusive. It is my pleasure to welcome Janna Levitt as our speaker for tonight's best lecture. Thank you.
Okay, well, first I need to get this awful picture off the screen. Thanks very much, Ted. That was a really kind introduction, and it's a real thrill to be here. I have to say it's always a bit odd to come back to the place that you went to school. I was commiserating, I guess, with Jamie Fulbert. He gave a lecture before the holidays. We were in school together, so there's a little soupçon of apprehension that may come through tonight. I also want to thank in my office Leanna Bressler and Drew Adams. Drew came to us through Ted because they helped with the presentation, because I was quite interested in trying to figure out what to talk about that would actually have some traction and meaning for the students first and foremost. Also, my partner, Dean Goodman's here tonight. Dean and I started the practice. Actually, Dean started it in 88 and I joined it in 91. We met in school and we had always talked about having the ability to form our own practice because in our experience in offices, we couldn't find anything that really resonated with us in terms of the kind of work that we wanted to do. So that was always a goal for us. And I would say we've expanded. We have a partner and other people. This is our office at the moment. I'd say the constants all the way along are have been a studio work culture that's really important not only to the work environment but the work we do. A flattened hierarchy, which in our office means the best idea wins always. Doesn't matter who it comes from. And our interest, based on our backgrounds, I came from a fine arts background. I'd gone to art schools in Canada and the States, and Dean was a design build contractor before he went to architecture school. So our interest is always to increase the area of operations for architects and architecture in our civic culture. So I'm going to take a couple minutes just to situate the idea about relational aesthetics and why I think it's really important for architecture and why it seemed to me to be the most truest representation of the work we do and the reason that we do it. So this is an image of Rickard Traviana, Fear Eats the Soul. I was lucky enough to go to one of his installations. He's one of the best known contemporary practitioners of what's called by Nicholas Boyd, relational aesthetics. And the quote here, the part that's really important for me is that it talks about the whole of human relations and their social context and why that's important as the medium of exchange rather than an independent and private space. It's not a new concept, so this is Gordon Matta-Clark, of course, and when he wasn't busy slicing up buildings, creating fake estates. He started a restaurant called Food with some colleagues in Soho. And it was like a laboratory and an extension of that of his practice that blurred the distinction between art and architecture and really questioned the medium of exchange. And then finally, Thomas Hirshhorn, another really well-known artist, mid-career artist. Again, this is in the courtyard of the Forest Houses in the Bronx. I was lucky enough to go and see this, and it really felt like going and seeing Noah's Ark. It's the most, I think, apt version or iteration of relational aesthetics that comes closest to a corollary with an architectural practice. It has two wings. One side has a bar, a workshop, a classroom, and a theater. The other side has a museum, a library, a newspaper, a computer room, and a radio station. And as Hirshhorn says, these are all the fundamentals of a civil culture. And I thought that was actually a really interesting way to talk about his practice and about the work. He offered philosophy lectures, kids' workshops, weekly theatrical performances, field trips, and art classes that he led himself. That's him at the bottom talking to one of the residents. He basically lived there for 6 months. And the thing that's really compelling about the way he talks about his work, one of the things that I find compelling is that he always says that his work is for energy. And he goes further and he says that energy is what we invest in things and in people, such as radio shows, newspapers, columns, classroom lessons, and conversations over coffee. It's present in decisions that take us out of our way and out of our depths. It's present in a work of art. And I guess I would argue that that same idea about energy can and should be present in any work of architecture. And then to help make the transition over to our work and to take this idea that's more of a fine arts practice and move it into architectural practice, Andrew Blovelt, who's the curator of the Cranbrook Art Museum, started to develop a theory about relational design, which was the architectural corollary. And he basically distilled it into three sections or phases in the 20th century, starting with isms or form, which was, you know, and the shorter house is a good example of that, to the making of meaning or content, and Venturi's duck, he says, is a great example of that, and then to more contemporary times of performative design. And that's about context and context-based work. And I think that Aravena from Elemental is a fantastic example of that. So if we just kind of go dig a bit deeper, and we say that the first phase defined forms and explored infinite forms. The second phase offered variable interpretations of form and meaning. The third phase, performative design, is about the multitude of contingent or conditional situations. And that, to me, is a very exciting place to start. It's talking about an open-ended as opposed to a closed system, and very much embedded in rational connections as opposed to reflexive imbrications or pattern making. So I'm going to present a number of our projects now, highlighting for me the variables that in every case are in some ways very arbitrary, but they're the variables that I would say are the energy sources that go into making a piece of architecture. And I'm going to highlight all the different constraints, goals, challenges, opportunities that generated our specific design responses. In many cases, what you'll see and what we always say is our work never always looks the same. It's very contemporary in form, but it doesn't look the same. But what's the same is the underlying aspirations. And each of these addresses a very different client base and a very different set of goals. So I wanted to start with Euclid House. It's actually a house that Dean and I built for ourselves, partly because it's a house of great experiment for us. And it was really a catalyst that allowed us to explore and generate some new ideas about issues that we thought were really important. And you'll see in the later work, they all come through. So we were the client. The house was, we always thought of the house as a demonstration project and also as a laboratory. Part of building the house and living in the house is finding out how much is a laboratory, how much is a demonstration project. And it's also about managing risk. And that's a very important part of the practice, particularly when you're starting to do work with new technologies and new issues, is you have to really moderate the risk and understand what can you do with your own practice that immunizes your clients, and what can you do in stages, and can you create opportunities for yourself to explore things and accept more risk than what you would put onto a client, unless you have a very extraordinary client who is very risk tolerant, which is not too normal. So we were the client, and really when we had two sort of main goals or aspirations, and one was to build small, to demonstrate how you could build a small house that still felt really great as a demonstration on a very typical mid-block condition. And I'm a part-time professor adjunct at Waterloo, so John Strobe always uses a pre-World War II middle-class house. Was about 1,500 square feet, and it immediately bloated after the war. So we used 1,500 square feet as the kind of size. So there was a kind of empirical metric, and then we had an idea that for us and the projects we were doing and the interests that we had, that city land, we had to start thinking about city land differently. We had to think about it as a productive site and not just simply as a substrate to put buildings on, that there had to be a reciprocal relationship, and they had to really work. And that this was really related to really fundamental and core ideas about sustainability and climate change, and that we had to really understand how exploring these issues would then affect architectural, fundamental architectural issues like scale, size, dimension, landscaping materials, and form making. And we think about it as a kind of reciprocal ecology. So there's lots of things to talk about with this project, but what I want to just talk about are one issue, which is the landscape and making a working site and what our first ideas about what a productive working site is in an urban context. So we thought about it as, and you can see here on the site plan, ground floor plan, our goal was to make as almost as zero hardscape coverage on the site as possible. And what that meant was it meant that we had to start using the site for drainage, to handle stormwater, to handle drought, to become a place to grow food, to get shade. We don't have air conditioning, so how to use landscape and cross breeze. And you can see in the section is all about the relationship between capturing breeze, putting it through the house, and about seeing out and seeing landscape and that kind of reciprocal relationship. And also we were very interested in extending this idea, and we noticed that people would always talk about their rural situations, their cottages, as this kind of bucolic ideal that, you know, that nature was really beautiful and that you could see birds and, you know, real affinity with the landscape. And our goal was, well, we think you can actually have that same relationship and affinity with an urban site. So I'm not going to show you anything the inside except this one shot, and because it talks about the things that we were able to explore that really relate to issues of, you know, ecology and architecture and relationships, which is, what do you do when all of a sudden your roof is 2 feet tall, 2 feet deep? Everybody loves thin roofs, including us. But if you're going to have a green roof, and especially at that time when we did this house, it was the first purpose-built green roof for a house. You end up having 2 feet deep parapets. So we thought, well, actually, that's really interesting. So if we work the section properly, we work the scale properly, in a room like this, we can actually raise the elevation so that when you're in bed, this can be a very small room, but you actually look out and see this landscape. And you end up having a view to a very active and busy landscape site that is changing over the seasons. And has an incredible array of birds and bees and edible plant material. And then I was just talking to the TREMCO representative. One of the things with respect to risk management is we planted all the roofs, and as I said, we were the first purpose-built green roof in the city of Toronto at the time, which was close to 10 years ago. And it was a real experiment. We didn't have very many options about what kinds of technology we could use or plant material we could use. We weren't quite sure about how you spec all the different layers. And it turned out that about 5 years ago, we found out that we didn't have a root barrier. And so we had to redo all of our green roofs, which, again, in terms of being able to manage the risk, it was something we could do for ourselves without... If we wanted to sue ourselves, so that would be one thing, but otherwise we were free and clear. But what it allowed us to do was to avail ourselves of all the new technologies, because the knowledge about green roofs and site drainage had increased exponentially. So what we decided on the third floor is this is the third floor, it's all sediments, but we actually planted 6 different kinds of green roof technology. Because we were at the point, we'd built the house, people, you know, liked it, the media had been very good to us, so people were starting to build green roofs, and we couldn't answer the questions about why should we build one kind or pay one kind of price for a green roof over another kind of price. So in doing this kind of experimentation, we could see over time, how long does it take for it to grow in, what are the challenges, what are the operating costs, some of the absolutely, and we have that on the second floor. So on the second floor, we were able to plant a lot of edibles. We have strawberries, onions, a number of different kinds of edible plants and herbs. And it's really a quite an interesting development over time. So within the course of 5 years and in redoing the roof, we were able to actually take advantage of all of the new technologies. And then Scott is in here somewhere, Scott McIver. I met Scott, and we started to be able to realize the laboratory aspect of the house much more in a kind of ongoing way. So We have the solitary bee experiment of Scott's at the top left. At the bottom left, we have a urban clover experiment with a postdoc student. And then on the roof, on the last 2 years, we've been working with Jode Roberts from the Urban Rangers. I'm very interested in bees. I'm a member of the Ontario Beekeeping Society. And so we have two hives on our roof. And so that's actually been really interesting to see what happens with that and how that is actually really fundamentally changing how the roofs are performing in a really interesting way. Plus, it's just amazing to be to lie out on the roof at night and see the stars and listen to the bees. So Market 707, that's right around the corner from you, Scadding Court, Toronto. Klaus, it's near one of your projects. This is interesting. This was an interesting project because this is more what I guess I would call a tactical urbanism project that has managed to stay put for many years. The client at the time was Scadding Court Community Centre, and what they wanted when we were talking to them was accessible microeconomic activity for their client base. And so we said, well, if you have it in the community centre, it'll be buried, there won't be street traffic. Why don't you put a lot of shipping containers out in the front, and we can help you design them in a way that's very affordable. And they're portable, so if you want to move them somewhere else, you can. What was really interesting is, again, so we start to get more and more critical mass of players as the projects get more complex. What was very interesting, this is the project that we call in the office the Ask for Forgiveness, Not for Permission project, because actually, working with the city councilor at that time was Adam Vaughan. There was actually no process in place to have this market on the Dundas side. It would have been mired in all kinds of procedural problems with the city, and as much as they were very interested in it, the roadblocks were profound. So he said, just do it, just get it done, and then we'll deal with it at that point. And in talking to the neighbors, so the Toronto Public Library has a branch there, but also the Toronto Western Hospital, which is right across the street, they have an ambulatory unit, and they want to get out into the community. So we ended up having a number of conversations with them about how can you integrate not just a market, but also other kinds of services. And these players actually continue to be part of the story and part of the dialogue. So because this project was done where we were involved really in a kind of conceptual phase because of certain constraints, what we did is we worked with the client, developed a series of sketches that really were about dimensions and relationships that were the ideal relationships for different kinds of community building, for transactional relationships, for the different kinds of economic development the client would want to have in the space. So, how high is a counter, that sort of thing. And we gave the client a number of sketches, and then they went away and arranged to have these fabricated. And so each container is actually two businesses. And they were dropped on the site over a weekend. And it's really transformed that corner of Bathurst and Dundas quite significantly and created a huge amount of interest internationally. And what's really interesting is it now offers a very successful business incubator for the Alex Park and Scadding Court community, but also it attracted local businesses that had a value alignment with what Scadding Court was trying to do. So Ideal Coffee is a perfect example of one of the first businesses that came in. Now they really got it, and that's part of what helped make it successful. And then you start to see over time, so this has been here for about 4 years, and you can see the kind of urban accretion that lovingly and haphazardly, in a way, starts to grow in and amongst all of the different boxes. So as you meet people's needs for shade, for sitting, for refreshment, for amenity, for places to recreate and to gather, you start to get an even more animated environment. One of the things that's also really interesting is that this is one of the few examples I can think of where the gulf between people with very low incomes and people, hipsters with higher incomes, actually can meet. And I'm not saying, I wouldn't for a minute say it's the architecture that did it, it's the program that the Scatting Court set up to create affordable micro businesses using very culturally diverse food as the main way to get people to come, and also for many people who come here who can't work at any other job, you can always cook food. It's one of the few places where there's a comfortable meeting of those two groups of people who don't often meet. And if anyone knows that corner with Alex Park, particularly before it started the regeneration, that was like a bit of a void in the city, and a place where people were really quite afraid to go for not really a lot of good reasons. The next project is the 100th branch of the Toronto Public Library at the Scarborough Civic Centre that just opened a little while ago. So in this case, the client was the Toronto Public Library Board, and this was quite a special project for the library because it's their 100th branch. It's also special for them because they had been promised a site for a library in this area since Moriyama did the heritage-designated, well-known Scarborough Civic Centre in the 70s. And the library had been part of Moriyama's plan, but they had never been able to locate a site there. And our challenge was to reorganize and reorient the precinct's disengagement. So the Scarborough Civic Centre is very disengaged, very much of its type an object building, very disengaged, it's up on a man-made hill from the street. So, and here are the players that were involved, the main players that were involved in that, and each one of them, again, had an impact on the final design. And it's in mediating all of these different players and understanding, as opposed to seeing them as constraints, but understanding and working on the assumption that everybody is working to get something done, understanding what all the pushes and pulls are about building in an urban condition. And so there were things like there was an existing oak tree that we had to keep. There was Moriyama's master plan and a new master plan that was not quite adopted that we had to then work on satisfying two master plans at a time. There was the TTC Scarborough line. The city workers at the Scarborough Civic Centre had to have a big say because they were actually inheriting this as a place to look after. And also, this area is now being designated as a community hub. So we had to actually forecast forward what some of the other uses were and site the building so that it could receive more development. So really, this is an exploded axon. One of the things that's quite interesting is you can see, let's see if I can do this. Well, there's the Scarborough Civic Centre, the big white block, and our library site was on the to the right at the bottom, conceived as a series of sloped roofs that worked its way up like a landscape up to meet the man-made podium that the Civic Centre sits on. But to the right, it was just an undifferentiated plaza, and we said, look, and we up at the top left, there's all these charts about walkability, and we said, this is a high needs neighborhood, you're saying that this is a community hub, we can't just have this undifferentiated plaza at the front, that's not successful when we want to build in success. So working again with the city and a whole host of other players, at a time when, during Rob Ford, when the libraries themselves were under assault, as was every civic project It was a real hard sell to get, but we have it, and it's stage two, and it's being done now. And another interesting and important part is the roofs of this are like the fifth elevation. And again, it goes back to the roof experimentation that we did with our house on Euclid. You can, because they're sloped in a number of different directions and at heights, you can see the planted roofs from the inside of the building. You can see them. There's a series of towers that surround the Scarborough Civic Center. You can see them from there. So it's like a verdant green landscape. You can see it from the Civic Center itself and also from the pathway up. And then we worked with trying to create a very generously shaded front sidewalk along Borough Drive to create a really pedestrian-friendly and cool place to walk. You can see here the plan. There's the oak tree that we had to work around, and it became an outdoor reading area. You can see the lines of the sloped roofs, and on the left you can see that one of the shots of the interior. The sloped roofs are above. You can see there's two elevations there. We purposefully used glulam as the structure here for a number of reasons. It's a lot from an acoustic perspective. It's way more effective as an interior material. It's far more expressive. We found for a large room. This is essentially a large room with different height ceilings. We felt that given the fact that this was a designated high needs neighborhood, and knowing our client and knowing our client's clients, the library patrons, it's very typical in a high needs neighborhood that the library becomes a place where you spend all day. And so having something like the glulam beams with the exposed fasteners and the very expressive structure, we felt actually provided a sense of ongoing interest if you're there all day.
Excuse me.
Sorry.
Please, sir.
What we did to try and work with the library's need for ultimate flexibility, which is one of the things libraries now need as they're constantly forecasting forward, what are their clients going to need in 10 years? What's a library going to be in 10 years? We ended up putting all of the desks and stacks on wheels. So with a single floor plan that you then can organize yourself around different ceiling heights to have more or less intimacy, you can then reconfigure the space quite significantly. And this, you can see it as at dusk, and the kind of transparency that is created, and the slope roofs become much more visible here. And to the left, you can see where the Civic Plaza and Civic Green is in the middle, actually, of construction now. And then we felt that this was actually a very compatible forecourt building to the Civic Center. It gave it actually a place and a stature that it didn't have before. It was just, an undifferentiated grass hill. This is an image from the inside, so you can see the big public room and the different ceiling heights. Unfortunately, when these pictures were taken, the roof, of course, was just planted, but by year three, you'll be able to see all the greenery through all the clear stories. And the grid of columns is actually, it's slanted in two directions, one for lateral loads and one to hold up two of the different heights of the roof. So you get a very dynamic interior that's really informed by the technological requirements and the structural requirements. And then all of that, again, is telegraphed through the fillets and connections both at grade and the bolted connections halfway through. This is the interstitial space and the new pathway between the Civic Center and the library. This is one of the areas that there's a little stealth move on our part. You can actually, if you go up this pathway, it is possible in the future to get up to the roofs of the library. That's it was a goal we had. The library went was interested, but then really couldn't imagine how to ensure that that was safe space. There's all kinds of precedents. There's this fantastic building in St. James Park in London, but it was just a bit too much for them to take on at this point. But the way that we have set this up and landscaped and worked close with the landscape architect, it is possible to do it in the future, and we hope that'll happen. And we've designed the roof to accept the balustrades if that ever happens, so you don't have to go back and do it. And then finally, a view from the reading courtyard back with the tree in the background, the oak trees that, that we retained. And again, you can see the big public room. And really, this is a kind of east-west axial view. And when the Civic Green is finished in the spring, during the day, you'll be able to see it. And at night, you'll be able to see a lit outdoor space. The next project, again, here in Toronto, is Native Child and Family Services. Again, actually right around the corner from the school at 30 College Street. The client was Native Child and Family Services, which offers two core programs. One is an Aboriginal child and child services. So children's aid, and then culturally specific services for the urban Aboriginal community. And so our task from them was to create a place that was culturally specific and also visible of the urban Aboriginal community in Toronto. Right now it's dispersed in different areas, and in many cases the image that's presented in the civic realm is not a public one. So the goal was to make a very public and proud declaration of this community in the city. It was also, the client said that they really needed to be able to have their clients reconnect with nature in the city, because many are don't have the funds to go to the country or go back to a reserve, or and so they need the kind of culturally specific native landscape experiences, but downtown. So you can see here there were even more people involved. It was a very fascinating process. We had a number of challenging Ontario building code issues and zoning issues, which I'll go into later, which we, in realizing our client's goals, had to really take on. One of the first things that we did, it was a very complex collaboration with all of these people, and one of the first things we did was have a series of consultation sessions that was led actually by Brian Porter of Two Row Architects. Brian is also a graduate of the School of Architecture. He has a practice on, I can't remember the name of the reserve, very interesting guy. And he helped us and helped the client do a kind of consultation session with elders, with Trent University, and a number of other people. Richard Hill, an art historian and curator from York University, who's now at Simon Fraser, and then a number of Aboriginal image makers. So we were also asked to create a contemporary iteration of what would be considered traditional Eastern Aboriginal form making. And it was very interesting because the client was very clear in saying, I'm not really quite sure what that is, but this is, it's very important that we reference this, and we don't want to be trite. We don't want a teepee doesn't mean anything to us. So that's part of what we'd like you to do. And so in the process of doing that and developing the architecture, it was really almost like a journey that you took with them about memory and recovering memory in a group of people for whom their culture was nearly obliterated. And so this actually had real meaning, and there was a lot of discussion about each of the materials and each of the forms and where the light was. So it was actually quite fascinating. So in the consultation phase with Richard Hill, he, as I said, is a curator, and he has really an ongoing documentation of all the artifacts, pan-Aboriginal, so from East Coast to West Coast. And one of the things that he had just found and he was very excited about was this artifact at the top left that proved that longhouses in the eastern part of the country actually did have a finished floor. It had a woven mat floor, and before that there had been no proof of that. And this was a very key discovery. So we used that actually in the bottom, used that as the basis for the design of the wood flooring in what we decided as the longhouse. And then with the image makers, we started to look at Peterborough glyphs. So what it was the kind of imagery and the stories behind that that would be relevant to include in the design of the building. And then finally, an investigation that we made with Richard's help and also with some of the faculty at Trent, with what were the speculation and also documentation of Eastern Aboriginal forms and whether they were residential or for meetings or for mercantile purposes. So that all went into the process. And then what was really interesting, one of the things that really stuck with me from what Brian Porter said is in contemporary Aboriginal culture, particularly on reserves, you don't waste anything. Everything gets used. If something is working, you use it, you don't throw it out. And so we use that as part of a kind of rallying cry. So at the bottom right, we said, okay, well, it was an existing building. Let's take off all the terrible finishes. It was a spec 80s office building. Grind the floor and then work with the image makers to do a contemporary iteration of a basket pattern, and we'll use that as a stain pattern. And so on the plan, you can see that goes from Cold Street all the way to Grenville, and it becomes the kind of mat, the ground floor mat. You can see in the center of the plan is the longhouse, our version of a longhouse, which I'll show you in a minute. And also, one of the other challenges is there's over 300 languages. If you look pan-Aboriginal across the country, there's over 300 languages. So how do you start to communicate when there's 300 really, clearly different languages? So we, with a graphic designer, Debbie Adams, we had a welcome wall where we used the language, we say welcome in all the different languages, and the size of the type indicates that percentage of the population in the country. Another big challenge for us that was really interesting was this really important connection between earth and sky. It was really from a ritual perspective, from a health perspective, from an identity perspective. There was always really this desire to have this relationship and actually clear view between the earth and the sky. So how do you do that when you have three rows of parking below and three stories of a building? So we actually cut out a kind of atrium space. You can see that here with the concrete block wall. When we punched out that opening to let light in, it also, we used that as an opportunity to do a stair that literally connects the ground floor up to the roof. That stair was done purposefully. It's a very generous stair because as it's the same time as there's a symbolic component of connecting earth and sky, there's a very real health component amongst the Aboriginal community with diabetes and a lack of exercise. So we thought, okay, if we make a really welcoming stair that goes through, and talked a lot with the elders and said, okay, if we have different places to stop along the way so that you can make it a very interesting journey, would that help encourage people to take the stairs rather than the elevator? And so that was really a driving force. And then we really wanted to have the longhouse, and you can see here the entry, at a place where it was really visually apparent from the street as well as from when you walked in. Here's the interior of the longhouse. And I think what you can see here, again, is informed by Brian Porter's, in part by Brian Porter's remark about not wasting anything. So we were very interested in how do you make a contemporary structure, learning, applying what we learned about the archival structures using birch branches, but also make it very economical and efficient. So we used a reciprocal framework with Dave Boak at Blackwell Engineers. It's the first time we had ever seen Revit, to work on a reciprocal frame, which is really the most efficient use of wood. So you get the best longest span with the least amount of material. To make a pattern that in and of itself has this kind of repeating texture that references earlier, what we felt referenced earlier, interior environments. And then it's lined with a series of white cedar skins. So again, the white cedar is an eastern product, not red cedar. All the projects I'm showing you have very limited budgets, so we were very lucky because white cedar is not considered a very great product in Ontario, so we were able to get it at a quite a good price, and the roughness of it suited the roughness of the building and of the space. And then you can see up on the roof, it's really again like the Scarborough Library, it's the fifth elevation, but in this case it's more than just an elevation. It's also program space, ceremonial space, decompression space. Very important, it's a kids' playground. So if you're coming for a meeting with a social worker and you've got some kids, they can go up and play on the roof. And it's divided into quadrants. So at the top left is a sweat lodge. That's one of the things, one of the issues that we had a huge problem with zoning and then with building. Basically, they did not want a sweat lodge on the roof at all. Then they wanted to have exit signs in the sweat lodge, and you need to have complete darkness, plus they would have melted. So we basically had to come up with argument after argument and finally said, look, think about this as a church. This is their church. You got to work with us, and we finally got it through, and we just had to add a little bit of a little extension at the beginning of the entrance piece. And then there's a part that's the teaching garden, so it culminates the elders going up the stairs with a group of people. They go to the teaching garden. There's the three sisters. You can see that here. So the three sisters, there's a tobacco going on the roof. Different plants that are used in different ceremonies. You can see the sweat lodge in the background. And then that's where the fire is. We really debated this one and had a lot of conversations with the client and the elders about having a real fire up on the roof and a real fire in the sweat lodge. And in the end, we decided that just was an element of risk that we weren't comfortable with and that we felt the client shouldn't take on because of, you know, just stray winds throwing embers around. And through a whole kind of a discussion, the client came to the realization that that's okay, that's part of being it's a part of the contemporary experience of living in the city and being Aboriginal and wanting to have this connection, and that you had to recalibrate your relationship with the objects. And then finally the sweat lodge here. So you can go back and forth between the sweat, having a sweat and having a ceremony. And then finally, Laurentian School of Architecture, which is under construction. Fortunately, it should have been finished by now, but I'm sure with your building as well, you're going through the same thing. Happy to say that, as Ted mentioned, Ted worked with us quite a bit on this project as a native Sudburyan, as well as a sustainability expert, in a way that his and our values really aligned in terms of what we thought real sustainability meant. And also Rob Wright is working on the project. He's doing the landscape design, which is quite a challenge. Again, very modest budget for a very outsized and ambitious program. It's been open. Part one is open. There's two classes there now, and the rest of the building will open in fall of 2016. So the client was Laurentian University, and the task was literally at that point there was no director, there was no student body. So it was here, make a new School of Architecture of the North, and figure it out what that means. So Ted's assistance and one of his key contributions was in working through with us jointly an idea about developing a site-specific sustainability strategy, which we call the LAL Manifesto of Sustainability, or Deep Sustainability, and getting the client to agree to go to leave the LEED program behind, although we agreed to track LEED as a LEED goal project, but to actually, if this is a northern building, what are the priorities for a northern building, and build and a sustainable project that actually talks about its context, its site, and all the pressures, environmental pressures, that that particular building faces in that particular site. So it's actually really interesting. So as you can see, this is the most crowded, and it was took a bit of editing to get just it down to this amount of people and the arbitrary but meaningful people that and organizations and government agencies that all had an impact on the final design of the building. And it ranged from the university, and then Terrence Galvin became the founding director after a year, which was really great because he actually put some substance around what the program was and what would differentiate the School of Architecture of the North from University of Toronto School of Architecture. So what were the actual academic goals that we could then inform the project with? Sudbury is a very interesting place because it's tricultural. It's actually more than tricultural at this point, but there's a very large Anglophone community, Francophone community, and Aboriginal community. And so the mandate and vision of the school was to be tricultural and bilingual. So that was an interesting mix. And then with that came another whole set of people who were involved from other academic institutions that we found out about, like OCAD, Trent, and Lakehead, who were all looking at the School of Architecture. They were all had programs where they're going very far into the north of Ontario to reach remote communities and help students make that journey from these remote communities down to, say, the city of Toronto. They felt that the School of Architecture in Sudbury was a great stopping ground where they could, start the decompression process that would allow them to be more successful when they got into an urban context. This is particularly true of the Aboriginal communities specifically. Then there's also the mining industry, which is really huge and very sophisticated technically. And so there was a lot of outreach to the mining industry and the Center of Mining Excellence, and they are way ahead of us in terms of imaging. And so we were looking at ways, can we actually physically relate some of our programs to theirs? And then finally, the Canadian Wood Council, who allowed us to use their funding to use CLT in part of the building. It'll be the first one in Ontario. So really, this it's still under construction, I'm just going to do the kind of higher level aspirations and design goals. So this really documents the north-south divide. So when we're talking about what's a school of the north, well, what's northern Ontario, or what's the north of Canada? Like, you have to sort of take a deep dive in and say, like, unpack the myth and what constitutes north and south in this country. And For us, it was really almost like an economic divide between North and South. And now, of course, there's a resource divide as climate change is opening up resource extraction in the far North. And so we charted everything from population densities, cultural densities, what was shield, what was forest, what was each composed of, active mines, mineral claims, land claims. And then also, even at the top, we talked, and it was really great to have Terry on board, of what are, if you look at the North globally, what are the northern cities or northern countries that have architecture schools that are very open about saying, we're schools that focus on northern architecture. So we said, let's get outside of Canada and start looking globally and see what's going on there and what are the hotbed issues about building in northern communities. And then we did a kind of, as I was saying before, a very extensive stakeholder consultation that we thought underlaw were one of the underpinnings for a truly sustainable project, in that we had to get buy-in from so many different people, so many different cultures, and how do you do that? So we had experts, Francophone, Aboriginal, Anglophone. So we had 4 months of extensive consultations about how to knit in this new project into the downtown of Sudbury. The downtown of Sudbury is in recovery mode, I guess, Ted, that would be fair to say. It had really been depleted population-wise, so the School of Architecture was going to almost, when it's full, double the population downtown. It's actually quite remarkable. So then what does that mean for the businesses? And there were decisions to be made. Do you make this standalone building, or do you say, actually, we're going to build less, which is, from a sustainability perspective, a very valuable thing, and rely on the community so you have a short walk to get your prints done. Don't do it in-house. So there were all those kinds of decisions to be made. Sort of getting, in the powers of 10, zeroing in on the site, what was really interesting is it's a triangular site, and there were three interesting axes. One is the urban axis was actually the original Trans-Canada Highway, and it crossed the north-south CNCP line, which was the original way that one went through the province or the city. And then the historic access, which connected with the Trans-Canada, which had a shed, which really had, in my view, not a huge amount of architectural interest, but had great affection by the community. And for that reason alone, and for some other reasons, it was kept. And then the telegraph building at the corner, where, because it was a small town, many people still remember going there in the 30s and 40s to send their telegrams. And so what we decided to do was to do a kind of campus approach with a permeable way through that would allow us to augment the urban access that was just basically a blank slate. And also, the city had just, again, done a master plan similar to what we had faced at Scarborough, and they had designated the train line as the new green line. Part of the impulse there is very similar to other northern communities and countries generally, which is how to get people out in winter to be active. And so part of this green line is how to get people out in summer and in winter to be active through recreation. And then with Ted's help, we developed, using the LAL Manifesto of Sustainability, we unpacked all the very, very site-specific issues and placed the building and tweaked the building so that it in itself was an instrument to modify and temper the environment so that we could get an interior courtyard that could be used, if not all the year, most of the year. So really big issues were the forces of erosion. Wind is probably one of the biggest issues there. Interesting with it being a northern city that it actually has more sun days than any other northern city. And it's very bright sun and very reflective sun, so that actually had a very big impact on the way we designed the south elevation. Very counterintuitive. And then working with thermal mass, and one of the things Ted really stressed was adopting as much passive design strategies as possible on the theory that at one time there will be no more energy or we'll run out of energy, and how long can we keep this building operating and the lights on when the furnace isn't running anymore. I'm sure everyone who's been taught by Ted has probably heard that, but it's actually a very provocative but stimulating way to start thinking about a building envelope and a site design and a building design. And then as we got deeper into the building, you can see at the bottom, the west wing is the CLT wing. Generally what we did was with the LAL manifesto kind of deeply in hand and deeply ingrained in our DNA for the design, we built a kind of partie that explored this idea about skin and bones. So the bones being the structure and the different structural systems. It was an architecture school. It was a building in the north that has challenges with certain building materials. And then the skin, we said, okay, let's look at every elevation. If it's a north elevation, we've got to have less light. We've got to have something that will withstand actually some quite serious winds coming at it. We've got to have something that's going to withstand weathering over time. And then on the left-hand side, you can see the studio block is a series of cascading decks that all face south, and it's in an exposed concrete finish, so it acts as a heat sink, collecting the heat for many of the days and capturing actually all of that great sun that, ironically, Sudbury has. We also worked with panelization for a number of reasons. The idea of panelization, both for the CLT, but also we have a lot of high insulation porcelain panels for the exterior walls, was allowed for a high performance building envelope in the north, and that's a hard thing to get if you're relying on materials there. It also increased the rapidity of construction. So when you're working in a context where there's a very short time to actually build and build well, panelization is actually a great way to fast track construction. And it also helped with what we found was a construction surcharge in the north. There is a cost for building to the north. Lots of things have to be brought there. And so the panelization allowed us a way to limit how much we would have to bear of that surcharge, particularly as this was an incredibly modest cost building. So that's the building envelope. And then with the tectonics and developing a strategy for the building that actually supported the goals both of the city and of the school, the school really wanted to engage with the community. One of the goals that Laurentian had is Laurentian is perceived as the ivory tower outside of the city. So Laurentian, locating the school downtown, they really wanted to allow a sense of engagement and encourage interaction. They also, it's a well-educated but a traditionally blue-collar town. But they're real makers, and this is a design-build student program. So it's much like rural studio in terms of the pedagogy of the school. So by having a courtyard and places, a fabrication lab that was actually related to grade that spilled out into the courtyard, the permeable courtyard that linked the greenway that anyone could walk through, was a way to start to break down those barriers and allow people to start saying, well, what are you doing there? And every year so far, they've been building fishing huts and getting a lot of cues. So this is, again, just some earlier renderings. The top is the historic axes. So you can see the shed, which we cleaned up and is now the fabrication studio. We put very generous overhangs on both sides so that the students can work in the shoulder seasons and engage with people. And this historic axis, that street also has a lot of cafes and student-friendly and more student-friendly shops. So we wanted to have a lower scaled, lower intensity elevation. And then the Greenway line, which is also the CLT wing, which is the most refined, has a prominent south face, and it is really, it is the one part that is the gathering point for the community and the faculty and the students, in that it has two auditoriums and a library, which will be used by the, rented by the community as well as the school. And then here are some images of the CLT going up. It's really quite remarkable how fast it went up and how elegant a material it is. It's in BC. It's my partner Brock just came back from a trip to BC. They so far ahead of the game there with respect to CLT. Dean and I took a trip to Finland where we were on tour of a number of libraries and housing projects, all of which use CLT in really interesting ways, prefabricated units out of CLT, really, really interesting. And part of the goal here was to use this as a demonstration, and the Wood Council was very eager to use this as a demonstration because all of this comes from Quebec. This is, and what the proposition is this is actually an expensive technology that could be set up in a place like Sudbury or another place in the north. It uses all the wood that you can't use for dimension lumber, so it's really a win-win in a lot of ways. And again, as we all know, wood is a great carbon sequestering agent. And one of the newer things that we're learning is that what's interesting about using wood is you have the sequestered carbon that you then take and use in your building, making room for new trees to sequester more carbon. So it's a very interesting and sort of forward thinking idea. And that wraps up the presentation. Thank you very much.
We have a few minutes for a few questions, but I guess we'll try to have most of the conversation outside over the reception. But if there's any questions, it's a good time.
Thank you.
That principle you mentioned, the work is for energy. I saw that in every one of your projects. You could see it in your very own home with the roof, the living roof. You could see it in Skadden Court, where it's generating human energy, community energy. It strikes me the visual for that is a pebble that the ripples it generates, and it's perpetual too. It's ever evolving and adapting. Whereas the construction, if I go along our lakeshore here, those hundreds of condominium buildings seem to be sinks. They seem to be negative energy, right?
Interesting.
When we talk about regulation, dealing with the civic bodies, can this be codified? Can this be regulated so that these principles enter into modern architecture?
I think what can be codified, I mean, Ted and I were just talking about it earlier, I think what can be codified is a more progressive zoning and building code regulations that recognizes the complexities of building and living in our time. And that doesn't look at those complexities. Again, it goes back to the whole relational aesthetics. It doesn't look at the complexities as negatives. It looks at them as productive elements. And so whether it's allowing for a different kind of zoning or allowing for a fast-track process so that things like the Market 707 can happen, that should be part of what happens and can support that whole other layer of life.
Gotcha. Thank you so much.
Great. Thank you.